Good afternoon. I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. My name is Craig Gleckler. I'm the marketing manager at CUES, and I will be your host for today. Today's topic will once again be on our CUES GraniteNet infrastructure inspection and decision support software. This time, we will be specifically focusing on our new AI defect coding service. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker for today's presentation, Mr. Edwin Esperanza. Edwin, take it away.
Thank you, Craig. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for joining us today. Again, my name is Edwin Esperanza. I am the technical sales consultant here at CUES for the CUES software division. I have a lot of responsibilities, but basically overall, I'm responsible for providing creative software solutions to our many different types of customers. Prior to CUES, I worked as an IT specialist for a managed service provider in Chicago. That's where I learned most of the information and most of the technology that we use today. And thank you again and welcome all who have joined us today and all of you who have found this video on YouTube. I hope you find this information I share with you today useful, and I'm able to shed some light into what our GraniteNet defect coding services and CUES as a whole has to offer. To start off, I'd like to share some information about CUES, if that's okay. CUES was founded in 1964, making us the oldest, in a good way, and largest manufacturer of CCTV inspection and rehab equipment in the world. For over 50 years, CUES has provided innovative pipeline infrastructure inspection technology and equipment to the global water and wastewater industry. Some of the tools we provide to collect data are pan and tilt cameras, small push cameras, pole cameras, sonar systems, radar sensors, the list goes on. Not only that, but we've also been designing software for over two decades. As of today, we're still the only manufacturer in the US that offers both hardware and software under the same roof, which makes it super convenient when collaborating on new ideas and innovations. Not only that, but our customers also benefit from this because there's one phone number to call for your hardware and or software questions. This makes CUES a true one-stop shop with our worldwide headquarters located in beautiful Orlando, Florida, and eight other service centers spread across the USA, Canada, and the UK. As of right now, CUES has well over 10,000 systems installed worldwide. So all that being said, we're not new to this, we're true to this. Today, we will be focusing on how we're currently using the power of artificial intelligence, or AI, to bring defect coding as a service to cities, municipalities, and contractors who have adapted the NASCO PACP standard. Before we jump into that conversation, I do want to shed some light on the current status of our sewer infrastructure. I'll be completely honest, it's not looking good, but we're making progress. We will also share some of the challenges cities and municipalities all across the US are experiencing with today's condition assessment methods. Then we'll jump into the benefits of artificial intelligence and the potential it has to revolutionize the way we collect and analyze condition assessments. And of course, it wouldn't be a CUES software webinar if we didn't talk about our pride and joy, GraniteNet. So we'll definitely cover how we're currently utilizing AI within our GraniteNet platform to provide a solution for some of these challenges our industry is facing. Lastly, I'll be sharing some examples of real world use cases and finish off with sample videos. The goal of this presentation is to bring awareness to a growing issue in our industry and provide you with the updated tools and information to be better equipped to regain control of our sewer infrastructure and keep those underground assets in optimal conditions for years to come. All right. I'm sure most of you are well aware of this, but the US wastewater infrastructure is deteriorating. In 2021, our wastewater infrastructure was given a D-plus rating by the ASCE, that's the American Society of Civil Engineers. Our infrastructure as a whole, meaning all different categories put together, was awarded a C-plus, which puts us out of the D range for the first time in 20 years. A large amount of our legacy water systems are suffering from chronic underinvestment, and their condition is only worsening as they get older. I actually read an article recently that said that there's a water main break every 2 minutes and an estimated 6 billion gallons of treated water lost each day in the US. That's enough to fill over 9,000 swimming pools. Sewer pipe failures are never a good thing. They cause environmental spills, which can be hazardous to the environment and can cause public health risks. For example, the collapse of a sewer line increases the probability of sinkholes in that area. Those are never fun to have to deal with. They're dangerous, disruptive, and can cost, at the very least, $10,000 to repair. Larger ones can cost upwards of $150,000 if they can be repaired at all. All that being said, state and local governments have been making progress as of late. Also, when there are funds available at the federal level, those have also positively impacted certain infrastructure categories. So it's not all bad news, but there's only so much that can be done with today's condition assessment methods and the resources available. Across the country, we're seeing that maintenance backlogs continue to be an issue, whether there's not enough operators available to collect the data, or the process is too time consuming, or maybe there aren't enough resources in the office to review the collected data. We're seeing similar bottlenecks across the board. Asset management does help prioritize limited funding, but to target investments and allocate funding, routine, reliable data must become the standard. Would you look at that? That's exactly what our solution is able to provide. But before we jump into that, I do want to share a few points about our current condition assessment methods and some of the challenges we're seeing with those. As I mentioned earlier, CUES has been in this industry for a very, very long time, so we've worked with many different organizations of all sizes, following different workflows. With the GraniteNet software, we've helped many of those folks better organize their data and streamline their process to make things more efficient for the organization as a whole. Still, there are some challenges that require a more sophisticated approach, things like cutting down the amount of time and labor involved with manual inspection and coding process, and removing inconsistencies in reporting and analysis. I mean, as humans, we're all subjective creatures. One operator might say a defect is a crack, but a different operator might think it's actually a fracture. It's subjective from person to person. Some other challenges we're seeing cities, municipalities, and contractors all around the US struggle with are data management, which is more prevalent with smaller entities, and high turnover rate with their staff. So now that we know the current status of our infrastructure and some of the problems we're seeing with today's condition assessment methods, I think it's time to introduce the solution we've all been waiting for. I won't call it that, but it is. It has proven to be a game-changing alternative to how we've traditionally gone about condition assessments. And that brings us to today's topic, artificial intelligence. No, not Steven Spielberg's movie, as amazing as it is. We'll be focusing more on what artificial intelligence consists of and the potential it has in transforming condition assessments and defect coding forever. There are many different branches to artificial intelligence and computer science in general, with even more being developed as we speak. But there are three branches that have provided us with the technology to bring our defect coding services with AI to life. Those are artificial intelligence, machine learning, and computer vision. Artificial intelligence, or AI for short, basically provides computers and machines with the ability to solve problems and make decisions similar to the human mind. In our case, these AI algorithms are capable of analyzing inspection data and accurately identify and code sewer defects based on the standard that the AI has been trained on. For our AI, that would be the PACP standard at the moment. Machine learning allows these computers and machines to imitate the way us humans learn. Without the machine learning portion, artificial intelligence can't be achieved. Think of it as humans going to school. Similar to us taking history class to learn from our ancestors' mistakes and make a better future for ourselves, machine learning models can learn from historical data to gradually improve defect detection accuracy and better assist in condition assessments. And last, but certainly not least, we have computer vision. The definition is pretty much in the name. Just like AI gives computers the ability to think, computer vision allows them to see. And the insights gained from computer vision can then be used to take automated actions, such as identifying and coding the defects that show up in the videos based on the historical data that we provided the AI. Now that we've broken this artificial intelligence term down, and you have a better understanding of how it all works together, you might be asking yourself, why is this important and how does it relate to the challenges we're seeing in our industry? Sit tight, I'm getting there. I promise there's a method to my madness. So let's start with the why. There's many variables to why an organization chooses to follow a specific workflow, whether it's limited resources, budget and time constraints, or just personal preference. Organizations tend to choose a workflow that best works for them and stick to it. A workflow provides your team with a daily routine and makes it easier for new staff to quickly learn how things work within the organization. Nothing wrong with workflows, but I'm a firm believer that there's always a more efficient way to get things done, and modern problems require modern solutions. So what does AI bring to the table? Overall, you'll see an increase in the efficiency of your workflow as AI automates the defect coding process, which greatly reduces the time and effort that's usually required with the manual inspection, coding, and review process. Speed to completion in the streets reduces traffic details, congestion, and increases linear foot productivity. Potentially more than twice as much footage per day can be collected, which means the overall weekly inspection productivity also increases. Also, you'd no longer need to worry about inconsistent data or error-prone personal biases, since AI would ensure standardized defect coding across the board, eliminating variations caused by human subjectivity and improving data consistency. You'll also benefit from improved accuracy in your condition assessments. Just like a calculator is able to solve math problems quicker and more accurately than the average human mind, computer vision and AI algorithms can detect defects much quicker and with higher precision than most humans are capable of. No offense to any of the truck operators present, you guys are all awesome and amazing at what you do, but AI is not playing fair. Also, let's be honest, nobody likes coding and reviewing defects all day. Let the machines do that tedious chore of coding your inspections while human capital can focus more on inspiring and innovative work. AI-powered systems can handle and analyze large volumes of inspection data, making the data easier to manage and review. Lastly, you wouldn't need to spend any of your precious time training the AI system. Our AI service relies on a reference library and machine learning to continue improving its accuracy, precision, and recall. Basically, the more data we feed it, the stronger it gets. Now let's dive into how all these pieces come together with our GraniteNet platform to provide a solution our industry has never seen before. All right, CUES Defect Coding Services with AI. So currently, CUES provides PACP 6 and PACP 7 coding services to carefully evaluate sanitary mainline pipelines. This allows field crews to complete work faster, reducing time in the streets and traffic detail costs. Again, there's also no worrying about coding quality issues or subjectivity amongst your operators, as the coding portion of the condition assessment would be handled by CUES and our AI service. In addition to benefiting your CCTV operators and field crews, engineers would also now be able to focus on projects at hand while ongoing inspections are carefully reviewed and coded by our AI service. This provides your engineers with consistent data they can rely on and allows them to focus on improving your infrastructure in a timely manner. We're seeing utilities and contractors use our service in several different ways. So you guys can use them for coding inspections that are being collected on a daily basis, but maybe you guys don't have the time or need to get a certain amount of footage done and can't code them all at once. You can send those to our AI service. We can code them and have them fully coded for you. Same thing with any archive videos that were recorded but maybe not reviewed. You guys have any of those, same thing. We can feed them to the AI and provide you with the coded inspections. And then also for training purposes. So to compare your field operators or contractors' data to what the AI is able to code, and then that way you can use that for training and just keep up with consistency. So how does this all work? All right, CUES Defect Coding as a Service is most efficient when using the GraniteNet cloud-hosted solution because the AI processing engine resides in the cloud, making it faster and easier to process large and often repetitive daily uploads of data. Using our GraniteNet web sync product, CCTV inspections are transmitted wirelessly from the field to the cloud when each inspection is stopped, making the upload process automatic and simple for the inspector. Also, data security is maximized using encrypted data transmissions throughout the day, removing the danger of malware and ransomware being spread through portable drives plugged into the network. Once the inspections are uploaded to the organization's dedicated GraniteNet cloud environment, they will be queued for processing by the AI machine. There, the CUES proprietary AI engine and its machine learning algorithms will interrogate the videos and classify PACP defect codes associated to the frames within the video stream where the defects are located. After the AI machine has rendered its initial evaluation, each inspection is routed to a certified CUES PACP coder for final review and certification. Once approved, the coded inspections are provided to the customer for final review and acceptance. Results of the service are made visible on the web via web office, as you can see in the picture, through real-time dashboards presented to data managers so that they have visibility into progress and can review the work done. The service is really that simple. All right, so these are some of the ways we're seeing our AI service being applied to real-world scenarios today. Artificial intelligence is capable of automatically identifying and coding sewer defects, saving you and your team time and reducing the risk of human error and subjectivity. Another way AI can assist in your day-to-day operations is by assessing the severity and prioritizing maintenance efforts based on the defects found during the inspection. This enables efficient resource allocation, and you'll be able to triage your infrastructure and focus on those assets that require special attention. Trend analysis and predictive maintenance is one that I'll jump into on the next slide, but essentially AI is able to analyze years of data to identify and eventually predict patterns and trends. This allows you to switch your workflow and maintenance strategy to a more proactive approach. Lastly, we have operator training and development. I know a lot of people are afraid of losing their jobs to AI. I'll be the first to tell you that we're not there yet in this industry. We love our operators. They're literally the lifeline of this industry. Nothing will get done without our operators. Instead, we use the inspections coded by our AI service to train your operators and contractors and enhance their skills so they know they have a better understanding of the different PACP codes available and when to use them. All right. So, what can be done after you guys receive those AI results? This is one of probably my favorite services we have available now. It's called Prescriptive Planning, and essentially is an annual service that provides you with automated rehab recommendations based on the defects that are being collected. As you can see there on the map, you can see it as part of the Esri. We can add it as a layer on the map. And basically you can streamline your operations so you can plan, you can send your crews or contractors out. They know exactly the type of work that needs to be performed. This is all performed by the software itself. So it also saves your engineers time coming up with a game plan because you essentially already have it in the software. You have those decisions and everything stays within the same software. So there's no need to spend time on integrations or money on integrations. Everything stays within GraniteNet. And that's called Prescriptive Planning, and it can be used as part of our defect coding service, and it can also be used on its own. So if you guys rather code your own inspections but still want Prescriptive Planning, we can make that work, absolutely. All right, so now for the thing that a lot of people showed up for, these sample videos. All right, this first one is a tab break-in. As you can see, before the camera or the transporter even moves up and gets to the point where that defect is, you start seeing those boxes pop up on the screen. So even if the operator might continue on or maybe not notice that tap, that TBI will still be displayed on the screen and recognized by the AI. Next one is a TSD. This is usually a rare and difficult to code. A lot of operators, or what we've seen at least, is this gets mistaken by a TBD instead of TSD. And if you can see it in the video, it kind of flashes into a TBD, and then after that frame, it goes to the actual code, which is a TSD, and that one sits on the screen. Next one is an infiltration stain. As you can see here, there's multiple stains on the line, and the AI is able to pick every one of them, no matter which side they're on. And lastly, this one is the fracture circumferential. This might be a little controversial because the camera is already pointing at it, but even then, this is a very hard code to spot, especially in that type of pipe. So the AI was able to pick that up and see it as a fracture circumferential. And I believe that completes this portion of the presentation. Thank you again for everyone who joined and everyone who stuck around. I think now I'll go ahead and pass it on to Craig, and we'll go into the Q&A.
Perfect. Thank you, Edwin. That was perfect. All right. As Edwin mentioned, we are now to the Q&A section of the presentation. So if you guys have any questions at any point in time, or as we're going through this, just use your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and type in your question. I'll read them to Edwin and give him a chance to answer. Edwin, we do have two questions that have come in so far, so we'll start with those, and I give everybody others a chance to answer questions, see if that works for you. You ready to go?
Sounds good. Yeah. I see some other ones coming in.
Yep. So our first question there, Edwin, is the data reviewed by a human after going through the AI process, but before you send it back to the customer? How does this human review impact the timeline for return of the data?
So it is, yes. So the first question, yes, it is reviewed by humans prior to sending it back to the customer, but after it is already coded by the AI. So basically it's like a security blanket so that we can catch anything that the AI missed and correct any mistakes that were made. Like I mentioned, this is a living, breathing technology, and we want it to be as accurate as possible. So we continue training it, we continue feeding the reference library, and the timeline so far confirmed, we've been able to deliver 25,000 feet of coded inspections back to customers within a week. And we're also increasing our service team. So that time should only get better, or that output should only get better.
Next question. Will the AI identify needed repairs and repair limits?
So the AI won't identify repairs, but prescriptive planning can let you know the repairs that it suggests. The AI will let you know the codes that are available, the PACP codes, and it will code those inspections for you. And then after that, you can use prescriptive planning to calculate those defects and have GraniteNet provide you with a rehab recommendation.
Next question, how long has CUES provided the service?
How long? We've been working with different customers. I know we did a pilot back in, I want to say 2020, maybe 2019 with Seattle. So this service has been around for a while. It's just now, we just now started marketing it, and we have some customers that are using it now. So we're getting some feedback and references. So I think it'll pick up now, but it's been around for a while. We've had it for at least 3 years.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. I think you kind of already answered this, but we'll just reiterate. So all coding is done by machine with no operator entry. That's a question mark.
So the way it works, since it's a PACP inspection, we would just need a clean video, a video that basically shows the whole line from start to finish, and the three codes that are required by PACP, which are the two initial codes, access point and water level. and then the encode, which is either an MSA or an access point. So as long as we have that, then we can go ahead and code the rest. And if that stuff's not available, we can still have the AI just feed them the video, or feed the AI the video, and then have it pick up what's available in the video. So we can also provide a test. If there's any videos that customers would like to test, we can run those by the AI service.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Edwin, you mentioned pipes. What about nodes and laterals?
We're not quite there yet. We are working with PACP at the moment. We want to make sure that the PACP AI coding is working as accurate as possible before we move on to LACP and MACP. But yeah, PACP at the moment.
Thank you. Next question. Does this work as the operator is recording, or does this happen after the recording is completed?
It's a post-processing service, so it'll happen after the recording has been completed. Yeah, it takes place on the cloud. That's why the cloud hosting solution for GraniteNet is usually the most efficient route to take, because we can grab the videos as soon as they're stopped recording. GraniteNet will ask the operator if the video or if the inspection needs additional coding by AI. If they hit yes, that makes it up to their cloud. From there, it has a flag so that we can go ahead and grab it and run it through our AI service. So it's a post-processing service.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question, I think this one might be more for me. Will this video, or I'm guessing this presentation, be sent via email to us? This presentation will actually be available on the CUES YouTube channel, as well as the CUES website within the next week. You should just be able to go to it, click on the link, it'll take you straight to the video, and you can watch it over and over as much as you want there on YouTube. Next question. How fast do our field CCTV tech need to perform the inspection for AI to pick up the defects?
They just have to follow the NASCO rules and regulations for the inspections, since it's a PACP inspection. As long as they're following the speed that NASCO requires, we should be able to code those without a problem, and the AI should be able to pick up the defects. Also, the AI does analyze frame by frame, so even if they're going a little faster, I'm pretty sure it'll be able to pick that up as well, because it's analyzing each frame in the video.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. What range in feet per minute movement is this effective and ineffective in?
I think that's the same question as the last one we had. I'm not sure about footage. I think it would be based on NASCO. It would be a NASCO regulation.
Okay. Next question. Are we able to use our own cameras?
Yes, as long as the video is in the MPEG-4 H.264 format, doesn't matter which camera is being used.
Perfect, thank you, Edwin. I think you already answered this question, but I'll ask it again. Can it do LACP as well?
Not yet, unfortunately, but we will get there. That's our plan.
Okay. Next question. Will the AI software be compatible with all cameras? Okay, I think you answered that question too.
As long as the camera is compatible with GraniteNet, or even if they're using another software, as long as it's a PACP inspection and the video is in the MPEG-4 H.264 format, yes, it'll be compatible with the AI service.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Are the human reviewers / coders CUES employees or independent contractors?
They're CUES employees. We're hiring new ones. They're definitely CUES employees.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. If you have a crack that is 6 foot in length, will it suggest a repair length of 6 feet to address that crack?
Yeah. Ryan, also, thank you for the just clarifying what the it was being AI. So if you have a crack that is 6 foot in length, we'll have suggested repair length. So again, the AI service won't suggest any repairs. That will be prescriptive planning. And if depending on the defect that is encountered, prescriptive planning can provide either a point repair or a full lining, dig and replace, repairs like that, or rehab recommendations like that.
Next question. Who owns the data once it's in the cloud?
The customer. The customer retains full ownership of the data. It's just hosted somewhere else. And if for any reason they no longer want to go with the cloud subscription, we will help them bring that data back to their environment.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. And I think you've answered this a few times too, but just want to clarify. Does AI software work with all CUES cameras, specifically the LAMP 2?
Yes. Well, LAMP 2, as long as it's not a lateral inspection, but yes.
Okay. Thank you. Next question. Is there a link for a full length AI inspection video to review rather than just the isolated clips that were shared? I think we already discussed this.
We discussed this earlier. We are working on a compilation of videos that we can share with customers and have available at the shows and during our demos. So we are working on that. So we should have that available soon.
Another camera question, but I think this is also important. Will this work with the duck camera, the CUES duck camera, or other pano type cameras?
It does work with duck. For the pano, like the other cameras, I can't speak to. We'd need a sample video so that we can run it through the AI, but it will work with duck, yes.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Does the AI code sag when the camera is submerged underwater?
That's actually a really good question. I believe it does. It does. And then it also adds camera underwater as a code if the camera is submerged for a long time. But it should detect a sag whenever the camera goes underwater.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Can this technology be used with service laterals that are typically completed by push cameras 4 to 6 inches diameter pipe?
Yeah, laterals are tough because we don't have LACP yet. We can test the video. Like I said, if you guys have the video, it's just going to be, it'll probably be a PACP, like PACP codes. And I feel like PACP and LACP, they don't have much of a difference. But we'd be willing to test it, Ryan.
Next question. Can the AI handle a PACP survey that contains codes and verify the codes and add or correct codes?
Yes. If there's any inspections that you'd like us to review that were collected either by a contractor or an operator, we can run those by the AI service and provide you with the what the AI was able to find.
Next question. It would seem that the amount of effort needed for the CCTV operator would not be significantly reduced since most of the runtime is spent setting up and operating the camera and not necessarily performing the coding. Can you elaborate, Evan, a little bit more, maybe what time can be saved?
Well, I mean, we've seen as much as twice as much footage being able to be collected because the camera is not sitting just there as they're coding the inspections. Some operators are very quick at coding inspections and they have their favorite setups so that they don't have to stop the camera as much. But other operators, it's not the same. So you can't, it's like you have your A+ operator that does everything right, but then you have the new operator that's just learning. So it might not be consistent across the board. So it should reduce your runtime and make those videos smaller because you're not pausing the video, you're not stopping the camera as much, so on and so forth.
And then once again, I'll just mention that, yeah, we are capturing all the questions and then who's submitting them. So Edwin will have a list of all that as soon as this meeting's over. Next question, are you offering a trial version to test out?
So there's not much of a trial. We can do a pilot on the cloud, which we can talk in a demo. But for the service, for the AI service itself, we can take 5 videos. If you guys have 5 videos you guys want us to test, you can send them over, and then we can run them by the AI and provide you with what the AI was able to find.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question is just kind of around pricing. How is the pricing for this service for AI and probably prescriptive planning done also?
The pricing, it varies. And I think it would be best to cover that during a demo.
Thank you, sir. Next question. How does the condition of the pipe affect this? Do we need to have clean pipes for AI to do its work?
If the pipe is clean enough to get the camera through it and get that video, then the AI can do its work.
All right, I think we've already answered this question a few times, but just around cameras, it does, as Edwin mentioned, it can work in all cameras. So I'll go ahead and skip that one, Edwin. Next question. Does the AI pick up on continued defects?
Continued defects, such as, the continuous defects. If the defect goes past a certain length, then it does. I believe by MASCO, it's 3 feet. If it goes past 3 feet, then the AI will note it as a continuous defect.
Next question. Would there still be a need for the operators to be PACP certified since the coding will be performed elsewhere?
I don't want to get in trouble with NASCO. You guys can do what you want, but there is certain things that the operator needs to know when it comes to the camera equipment and performing the actual inspection. So at least that knowledge would be needed by the operators.
Very diplomatic answer there, Edwin. Next question. Will support be available 24/7, and would the data still be transferable via thumb drive?
So support is available during the week, unless it's requested by the customer. I mean, the data will be on the cloud, so it will be accessible 24/7. Transferable by thumb drive. I mean, since it's on the cloud, you guys will have web sync on the trucks. And the web sync module will be able to communicate directly with the cloud. So thumb drive, I mean, it'll work for an on-premise environment, but the AI service is not available on-premise.
Okay, here we go. Edwin, there's another question for you. Have independent studies been done? How accurate have you found the AI engine to be?
Independent studies, I think that will be, again, a question for the people that have been working on developing the AI and getting it to the point that it's been now. I don't know if we have any studies. I know we have reference, and I just heard from them earlier in the week that everything is going great. They like how the service is running. They've been able to TV more, have the trucks out there more often, get more production done while the AI does the coding.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Not sure on what the title of this is, but I'll give it my best shot here. These guys use Titler to mark defects on video. Is that the correct pronunciation of that? Do you know, Edwin?
Titler. Yeah. It's like a overlay, video overlay, the titling.
Gotcha. All right. Will the text on the screen affect the AI negatively?
It shouldn't. I know that the AI, if the code's available, or if the footage is available, I mean, that'll help the AI because it'll know where those defects are. If not, we can go frame by frame and just put the defect where it ran into that in the frame if there's no overlay. But the text shouldn't affect it negatively though.
All right, next question. Does CUES have any current case studies on the utilization of AI tooling?
We're working on case studies. We don't have one yet. We just have a reference at the moment.
Okay, next question. How long will the AI take to return the coded video?
How long? I mean, the AI finishes the coding within a couple seconds, maybe a couple minutes, depending on the length of the video. It's more on the service side, and we've been able to, like I said earlier, we've been able to deliver to customers up to 25,000 feet per week. So once the AI is done coding, then the service team basically goes through it one last time, puts the NASCO stamp on it, and we deliver it right back. And it's not like we're going to be just doing it in batches. So as soon as they're done with that one inspection, we send it right back and they'll be able to see it on their end. So it'll flow through it, through the inspections that they send in.
Yeah, next question. Does the post-coding process remove the operator's coding? I think you already kind of answered this, but I'll keep asking. For example, if we entered an MGO for something specific, will it be removed after your coding?
Yes. Any MGOs, any coding that was done previously, that will be corrected by the AI and our service team.
Next question. Their municipality uses a pan and tilt camera, which is a bit older. Will the AI system record audio, and will it conduct normal without any additional cost coverages besides the support plan? That's some stumpers for you today, huh?
Yeah, they got some good questions today. So will it record audio? I'm not sure if it'll record audio. I know it's using computer vision, so it'll definitely see the video. As for the audio, do you mean will it say what the defect is on the video itself once it's done coding? I'm not sure if we're able to provide that. But again, I think we'll get you an answer. We'll confirm an answer for you, Corey, with the service team. And regarding the cost, additional cost coverage besides the support plan. So there is an additional cost involved with the AI service, and it ranges, but we can definitely get you that answer. And I'll send some brochures because we have that information on our brochures as well.
But they wouldn't need to do anything to their actual camera, correct? For it to be
able the camera, as long as if you're using GraniteNet, if you have the MPEG-4 H.264 module, then we should be able to work with that camera because it'll still be in the format that the AI needs.
Thank you, Edwin. Next question. Are there any file size limitations? If so, what is the max file size permissible for processing?
File size limitations, not that I know of. I don't think we have any limitations. As long as the format is H.264, yeah, the video doesn't matter how long it is. It's more of a concern since it's going to be on the cloud. We want to make sure that you guys have enough cloud storage so that it can hold that video so that we can go ahead and run it by the AI service.
Thank you, Edwin. I think we're coming up on one of our last question here right now. Is the intention to allow contractors to QA the AI coded videos, or is that only going to be checked by a CUES service team?
So before you guys even get the videos, those have already been certified by the CUES service team. Once they make it back into the customer's hands, they've already been reviewed by the service team. You guys can still do some Q&A on it, see if there's anything you find, but it's already done by our service team before it makes it back to the customer.
Thank you, Edwin. I think that about does it for our questions.
I appreciate you, Chad.
Chad had a nice compliment there to Edwin. Yeah, thank you, Chad. I'll give you guys a few more seconds here to ask me more questions. If not, we'll go ahead and end the presentation. I'll give you just another 10, 15 seconds here, see if there's anything else. All right. That looks about it, everyone. Oops, hold on. One more question just came
Megan,
in.
As I said, Megan just sneaked one in.
As I said it there, okay. Does the AI use all data coming in from all customers to update or adjust the machine learning algorithm? Or is the algorithm updated, adjusted using specific data?
So not all data, because not all data will be good data, but once it's looked over by a service team, we do add that those videos or those photos to the reference library. So the AI can just keep on learning and the machine learning can just keep doing its thing. So yeah, not all data, but just the ones that are cleared by the service team.
Thank you, Edwin. Okay, everyone, I think that's about it for the questions. Thank you so much for today. And that does wrap up our webinar. We want to thank you all for attending today and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding our new GraniteNet AI defect coding service or prescriptive planning, please feel free to reach out directly to Edwin. His contact details are on your screen. You can also always visit the CUES website for more information. Once again, thank you all for attending.